You're listening to The Gary Harris Show on Tide 100.9 in Tuscaloosa.
Fans of golden fried chicken fingers are happy as Tuscaloosa's third Guthrie's is now open in its former location on Skyland Boulevard.
The Gary Harris Show. You see him host Tider Insider TV, Crimson Tide Kickoff, play-by-play for Alabama sports, and sports director for WVUA 23. It's time for The Gary Harris Show on your home for Alabama sports, Tide 100.9, and streaming on the Tide 100.9 app.
Here we go. It's Friday, April 19, 2024. I know it's overcast outside. I know we got some rain last night. Baseball got washed out, but it's Friday, and it's the TGIF edition of the Gary Harris Show. Only thing I feel bad about is when I had Rob Vaughn on yesterday, Justin, I was talking about, hey, well, the weather's going to be great. I didn't even know it was supposed to rain last night, and it really was a small pocket of rain, but we got it, and the game got postponed until today, so now they got a doubleheader beginning at 11 a.m. Real quick, Justin, what does that mean? That my show's the last show on Tide today, or how's that going to work?
Yeah, I've not confirmed anything yet, but I believe so. I think we'll get to the end of your show, and then we'll go straight to baseball.
How about that? So, but anyway, that's what happens when you don't play. I really thought they would try to play last night because there was no lightning or anything associated with the rain, but it was a pretty steady steady rain for most of the night. They did get the concert in with Riley Green over the Tuscaloosa Amp, and more on him in a moment with in terms of Alabama baseball. But anyway, welcome in, everybody. It's the TGIF edition of the Gary Harris Show. I'm Gary Harris. Justin Jones right there on the other side of the glass, manning the controls, taking your phone calls on the First and Main Condominiums hotline in hour number one, Krispy Kreme Donuts hotline in hour number two, 205-342-9904, 205-342-9904. Jam-packed show that we're going to run it down, all the info for you here in just a moment, and also get to some news and notes. But first, I have to tell you, this hour of the Gary Harris Show brought to you, as always, by Alabama Credit Union. Convenience and savings make life better. The ACU Lifestyle account is available right now. Learn more at alabamacu.com, alabamacu.com. Alabama Credit Union, loans for real life. Some rules and restrictions do apply. See if you're eligible for membership. Then join today and feel good about your money and put a little extra change in your pocket. All right, the lineup for today, Adam Amin from Fox Sports is back. Haven't had him in a couple of weeks, but he'll be with us at 9:30 to go around the world of sports. One of the most talented play-by-play broadcasters out there, does Fox Sports baseball, Major League Baseball, NFL football, also does NBA hoops for the Chicago Bulls, who have a big game tonight, obviously in the play-in against the Heat. And he also does Chicago Bears preseason football. So he's a Chicago guy. So we'll ask him, obviously, about the Bulls and their chances of beating the Heat without Jimmy Butler. The Heat, that's what happens sometimes. Injuries play such a big part. And you've got Chicago without Butler and New Orleans without Zion Williamson. So their teams are obviously affected. At 10:30, it's the Auburn Report with Brett Pritchard. Also, our Krispy Kreme Donuts for a Year and T-shirt giveaway. We're going to do that at some point this morning. Have a lucky caller that qualifies, and we've got a couple more weeks of that promotion. But a lot of people that I think we've had three winners so far, and they've all told me they're enjoying being able to go buy Krispy Kreme and get a dozen donuts once every month. Donuts for a Year. So before we get to our phone calls, I know we got Corey on hold wanting to talk softball. Corey, we'll get to you in just a moment as Alabama softball is at Arkansas this weekend. But I'm going to go ahead and hadn't done it in a while. Let's hit him off with some Friday morning TGIF headlines here, Justin, on the program. Bama fans were chanting rain, rain, go away, but it just wouldn't. As a result, the Alabama-Texas A&M baseball game scheduled for last night has been moved to today as part of a doubleheader at Sol Thomas Stadium. Friday's doubleheader will begin at 11 a.m. with Game 2 set to start approximately 45 minutes after Game 1. And both of the games will be nine-inning contests, so it's going to be a long day of baseball over at the Joe. Saturday's series finale will remain scheduled for a 2 p.m. first pitch at Sewell Thomas Stadium. Of course, Texas A&M is ranked number one in the country. And speaking of Alabama baseball, country music star Riley Green, who was in town for a concert on Thursday evening at the Tuscaloosa Amp, took batting practice with the Crimson Tide yesterday afternoon. The 35-year-old Green, who played quarterback at Jacksonville State, quite an athlete and showed it. I saw the, I ran the video last night, Justin, on our sportscast. He's big, dude. That Riley Green guy, the country singer.
I didn't realize he played quarterback at Jacksonville
State. He sure did. And he's a heck of an athlete. He took batting practice. He barreled up a number of pitches and took a couple of them out of the yard. How about that? Listen, dude. Yeah, he was a quarterback at JSU, but he's a big dude. I was looking at the video. I'm guessing 6'4", probably, I'd say 215, 220 pounds, and it was not soft.
6'4 is a good guess. That's what they have him as.
There you go. Big, big dude and a heck of an athlete. So that was fun for the players, even though they didn't get to play the game last night. The Alabama Crimson Tide Gymnastics Squad competed in the second semifinal session of the NCAA Championships last night at the Dickies Arena in Fort Worth, Texas. They were in the semifinal session against top-ranked Oklahoma, Florida, and Utah. Alabama started on the uneven bars and did really, really well. But their second event was the balance beam, and all I have to tell you is four falls. Done. I mean, it's so disappointing. They're not trying to fall. I get that. But you work all year to get there. And if you get beat, you know, it's one thing. You get eliminated. But when you have to count three falls and you fall a total of four times, it's and you still got to go ahead and do vault and floor, and you know that it's over.
Well, I was keeping up. I believe, was it Juliet Brown was covering it for you with WVUA, and the controversy there is
they said
the beam was moving.
Yeah,
and they had to go in and fix it, of course, after Alabama already had their routine.
Did anything else come out of that this morning?
I've seen nothing other than they acknowledged that it moved. They fixed it in time for, I believe, Oklahoma's next routine on it. And nothing else. They counted Alabama's falls and counted their scores.
That's tough. Well, it didn't help Oklahoma too much. And one of the bigger shockers that you're going to have in college sports this year, Oklahoma, who has been a dominant number one, much like in softball. I mean, their gymnastics program has been at the same level. I think that they were – I know they were undefeated this year. Justin, I don't know if they lost a match last year, but they were the odds-on favorite to win the session in advance. Didn't happen. I mean, they had all kinds of problems. They started on the vault, and they were falling on their landings on the vault. So Alabama and Oklahoma did not advance. I have to check in more to this moving balance beam thing for sure. And if anybody out there is a gymnastics fan, And I, you know, Juliet Brown was keeping up with constant thread updates for WVUA 23. But if you know anything more about that and why, first of all, why is it moving? And secondly, you know, if it was moving, then why was it adjusted for other teams? I mean, it should be the same for everybody. I don't know. If you know anything about that, let us know. So as a result, it was Utah and Florida that advanced into Saturday's championship final. And in the first session yesterday, we had help me out with the first session because I thought I had it in my notes, but I don't. We had another SEC team, LSU and Cal. That's who it was. Yeah. LSU and California advanced. So your final on Saturday afternoon will be Florida, Utah, LSU, and Cal. So you'll have two of the four in the final from the SEC. So the SEC is going to have a very good chance to win a national championship, particularly with Oklahoma out of the tournament. So disappointing night for Alabama gymnastics. More disappointing, though, for Oklahoma when you consider how dominant they had been. Well, former University of Alabama head football coach Gene Stallings, who led the Crimson Tide to a perfect record in 1992 national championship, spoke to the media yesterday prior to the annual chip-in for Rise on Thursday at North River Yacht Club. The 89-year-old Stallings was accompanied by his wife, Ruth Ann. What a great couple. He was on hand to support and promote Chip-In for Rise as well as the Rise Tournament of Champions Golf Tournament. The events are the Rise Center's largest fundraisers of the year. The Rise Center serves children with disabilities and their typically developing peers. Coach Stallings is a longtime supporter of Rise, and the Stallings Center that serves as home to the Rise Center is named for Coach Stallings' late son, John Mark. Coach Stallings on hand again at 89. Justin, I think that is so cool. And he flew back into Tuscaloosa with Ruth Ann and spent the day over at North River Yacht Club. We got a Bama in the NFL update. If it's not broke, don't fix it. And as far as Dave Canales is concerned, Bryce Young isn't broken. The head coach of the Carolina Panthers, the new head coach, just wants to put the second-year quarterback from Alabama in a position to do his job and be successful. He said yesterday at their pre-draft press conference, Justin, that the bottom line is he just wants Bryce Young to do his job. And he referenced back to Alabama. He said, you know, when Bryce Young was Alabama, he had a good offense, he had a good defense, and he made plays. He said, that's our goal, is to put good players around him, not make Bryce have to do anything special. I like that concept. Problem is, they don't have many good players. So they better get on it, and they better get on it quick if that's going to be the case. So, as we said, Arkansas host Alabama in a three-game SEC softball series beginning tonight in Fayetteville. The Crimson Tide is 7-8 in SEC play, and the Tide has never finished with a losing record in the conference. So, a lot of softball left, but they lose this series, you know, that's going to put them a couple of games under 500, and they could be looking at doing something that they've never done and doing something on the bad end of things. So it's a big series this weekend. We'll talk more about that as we go on. In fact, when we come back on the other side, we'll start out with our phone calls, and Corey from over in Trustful will want to fill us in on Alabama softball, so we'll get to him. All right, it is the TGIF edition, which means we're going to get that great weekend music, too, to get you ready. And every time coming out of the break, we're going to have something that's weekend-themed with a lot of energy and excitement because we are ready to go. Always have fun. Adam Amin coming up at 9:30. And let me say this, too, real quick, if Tom is listening. Justin, you weren't here, but I was listening to Fox Sports Radio last night, which we carry, and the show, I forget the two guys that are on it, Rob and Chris, and I forget their last names, but anyway, something we used to do here on the Gary Harris Show, I guess they stole it from us. That's what I'm going to say. I turn it on, and they're saying, welcome into TV Show Theme Song Thursday. Well, the originator of TV Show Theme Song Thursday was the Gary Harris Show. We did it for several years. And then I turn it on last night, and I hear it on Fox Sports Radio.
You need to go get some royalties.
Yeah, I'm telling you. I mean, and I know there's been a lot. And we also used to do Bumper Music Trivia Wednesday. So may have to bring those back. But Rob and Chris.
Chris Broussard and Rob Parker.
That's it. You got, thank you. Yeah. Who, I think they both at one time worked for ESPN. Now they work for Fox. But yeah, Chris Broussard and Rob Parker do the early evening show on Fox Sports Radio, which we run here on Tide. And I turned it on and I said, yeah, welcome into another TV show theme song Thursday. And I said, man alive, that's the Gary Harris Show's theme song Thursday. It wasn't just theme song. TV show theme song Tuesday. It was TV show theme song Thursday. We used to do it every week. And to kind of fill you in on how we did it, unlike they just play the songs, we would do something where we would play them and people would try to tell us what the theme song TV show was. And then on Bumper Music Trivia Wednesday, we would pull an album and we play a different cut from that album coming out of every break. And we'd give away a prize. And I can't remember exactly how we did it. But anyway, we're off and running here on the TGIF edition of the Gary Harris Show. And we're going to be back with phone calls and Adam Amin at 9:30. And we've got a jam-packed show. So you keep it dialed in right here on Tide 100.9 FM and 1230 AM WTBC, your home for Alabama sports.
This season of Alabama football on Tide 100.9, brought to you by Birmingham Racecourse Casino. Just a few minutes away where you can be a winner, too.
From the University of Alabama, this is Crimson Tide Today. It's a daily update on Bama sports, and it's brought to you by Guthrie's, America's original chicken finger restaurant, is now an official partner of the Alabama Crimson Tide. For franchise information, visit GuthriesChicken.com. Hello again, everybody. I'm Roger Hoover. On yesterday's edition of Crimson Drive, driven by NASCAR, we were joined by Alabama baseball pitcher Zane Probst.
Yeah, you mentioned this weekend. Now we've got 5 weekends left in SEC play, SEC tournament after that. Going to need some wins to make sure that in June baseball's played here in Tuscaloosa. Yep. Just how motivating is that for you guys?
You know, we're not going to try to think about it too much. I think just the goal every single day is one game at a time, or one pitch at a time. So, I mean, we definitely know what we have to do, and this was a good start this past weekend. Now we have another great challenge and opportunity in front of us starting today against another number one team rolling in here to the Joe. So, you know, I think if we bring the energy and have the confidence that we did last weekend, and we can just keep carrying that forward, and then the, you know, the wins will stack up on their own and pile up. So we're about to get rolling, and the second half is going to be very important for us. We want baseball back here. We want another regional big time, obviously.
I'll have more in a moment.
Founded in Haleyville in 1965, Guthrie's Golden Fried Chicken Fingers has been family-owned and operated in Alabama for over 58 years. Like their famous signature dipping sauce, Guthrie's has been imitated but never duplicated. Using the family's original Southern Fried Chicken recipe, Guthrie's is still serving the best chicken fingers in the world. Just like you like them. Fresh, hot, and fast. Guthrie's, America's original chicken finger restaurant, and now an official partner of the Alabama Crimson Tide. For franchise information, visit GuthriesChicken.com.
Join us the rest of the weekend for Crimson Tide Baseball here on the Crimson Tide Sports Network. Game 2 of the Texas A&M Series starts at 6 p.m. on Friday, followed by
us. Get after it!
Limited time discount available online only, while supplies last. Taxes extra. New customers only. Must activate the device within 30 days to avoid paying full price. Offer subject to change.
Tide 100.9. Tuscaloosa weather.
The weather stays warm today, mostly cloudy through tonight. A few scattered showers or thunderstorms possible. The high today, 84. Tonight's low, 60. Tomorrow, mostly cloudy. A few passing showers are likely during the day. The high, 74. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 68 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
You see him on WVUA 23 covering sports. And on Tider Insider TV on Tuesday nights. Don't miss a minute of the Gary Harris Show. Weekdays from 9 to 11 on Tide 100.9.
What a beat. Let's get you going. A little Mick Graham and the boys. Foreigner brings us back into the Gary Harris Show on this TGIF edition. Yeah, we're ready, man. We're ready for the weekend. Even though, again, the baseball last night washed out, and it's a shame because I always kid that Tuscaloosa has a lid on it. Usually there'll be rain all around, and Tuscaloosa will be dry. Last night was just the opposite. It was dry all around us. Justin was just telling me he went to his little brother's baseball game in Demopolis. Not a drop of rain. A lot of areas didn't get any. But we got it. And, man, it washed out that Thursday night game, and we got a doubleheader beginning today at 11 a.m. right here on Tide 100.9 FM. All right, let's jump out on the First Domain Condominiums Hotline, presented by First Domain Condominiums, luxury condominiums in beautiful historic downtown Northport, firstdomaincondos.com. And our pal Corey from over in Trustful, I know, is ready to go ahead and break this softball series down for us. Good morning, Corey.
Good morning, Gary. How are you this morning?
Doing well.
Well, first of all, let me go back to the A&M game Monday. That was unacceptable in a lot of ways. I get that you tied the game, which was great, but giving it away like that was unacceptable because that's not how Alabama plays. And it's kind of been a microcosm of the season in a lot of ways. And you work so hard to tie the game back up, and your defense and pitching just lets you down in so many ways. And it's been a bad trend recently. And I honestly don't know how you fix it.
Well, you catch, you know, you make more plays on ground balls. I mean, I think you fix it by playing better. I don't think this team. I do think there's a talent gap between Alabama and the top teams in the SEC. I do. I've said that. That's my opinion. But they're talented enough to make routine plays on ground balls and make throws and not drop pop-ups. I mean, I'm not buying. Maybe they're not the best defensive team, but four errors. You know, I think seven in the series. They've had games with multiple errors this year. I think that can be fixed, Corey. I think they're better than that. I got to believe that they're going to get better defensively, even though I know we're deep into the season. I understand that, but I don't think that maybe this team, as I said, they're still 30-10. Okay. I mean, they're still won 30 games. So I think they can fix it, Corey. I think they can play better defensively than they've played. And maybe I'm wrong. You know, maybe you're dead on and right. But I don't think, you know, every now and then there's going to be a tough play and you're not going to make it. I get it. But four errors, and I think how many, you follow closer than I do. How many errors, I mean, I think that's two or three games where they've had four errors or more, isn't it, this year?
Yeah, and I think in SEC play alone, they lead the conference in errors.
Yeah, I have no doubt you're right about that. So, but I do think they can play better defense than they're playing. So, and you're right, they're going to have to, because you got to give A&M credit. That's a good team, but that was anybody's game to be had. And on Monday night, and they wound up losing at 9-4, primarily because, as you said, self-inflicted wounds. It was more what Alabama did to themselves than what A&M did. Now A&M took advantage, but you can't give these teams, you know, extra outs. I mean, there's 21 outs in a 7-inning softball game. They gave them 25 outs. I agree. You're not going to win the game against a good team when you give them four extra outs. And that's what they did. And I'm with you on the fact that if they keep doing that, they're going to keep losing games. But I do think they can play better defense than what they're playing. Surely to goodness they can.
Do you think this is still before the game started, they said Alabama was on the super regional bubble. Do you think Alabama could still get there, or is this just...
Yeah, I think they could still get there, sure. I mean, because you've got, beginning with this series on the road against Arkansas, you got Tennessee coming in here next weekend. Man, you beat Tennessee. You want a series against Tennessee? I mean, you got three series left, okay? If you win all three of those series, which I'm not saying that they will. In fact, I don't think that they will. But if you win all three series against Arkansas, Tennessee, and Auburn, yeah, you're going to be in line to host a super regional. But if you don't, in other words, I think they're going to have to play themselves into the super regional. And, you know, last year, man, they got a really fortunate seeding. I don't think that's going to happen this year. They're going to have to play their way in. You got nine games left. You know, honestly, I think they probably need to win six of those games. So I don't right now, if you're asking me my opinion, do I think Alabama will be in line to host a super regional? I'm going to say no, because I think they're going to have all they can do to win this series this weekend. I know it's in Tuscaloosa, but I don't see them beating Tennessee 2 out of 3. And then Auburn's playing better, and it's at Auburn. So I think they can play themselves into hosting a super regional, but right now, I don't know that they're going to be able to do that.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, Tennessee is by far and away the best team in the SEC. It's hard to take two from Matty Penta and Auburn.
Right.
And Arkansas, even though we all know Arkansas used to be a pushover, but they're not a pushover
anymore. No, they're not. They don't hit like they've hit in the past. But I think probably Alabama right now, because you mentioned Penta down there, I think the best chance to win one of these three series is to win this one this weekend. So, and if you win this one, then you get some momentum coming home against Tennessee. So this is a crucial series for Alabama, because it's a winnable series, and you win a series on the road against a good team. One team's ranked 16th, one team's ranked 14th, so it's pretty even teams. This is a big momentum series, because if they lose this series, Corey, let's just be honest. You're right. Tennessee's better than Alabama, and I think they're going to win that series. And then, you know, it's going to be tough at Auburn. If you lose this series this weekend, shot at hosting Super Regional is probably down the drain.
Yeah, and if you lose this series and then Tennessee, you're probably looking at possibly a 14 or 15 seed.
Yeah, it could be. So, I mean, but let's hope, you know, let's hope they can turn it around. I you know, it's just like the A&M series. If you play clean and they beat you, then you know what? You just move on. But to play as sloppy as they played and they won the first game. I mean, Beaver pitched a gem on, you know, Friday and on Saturday, and they won that game 2-0. And then in the next game, sloppy, and they give up more runs than they've given up in the history of the program. They gave up 17 runs. So, and then you follow that up, losing 9-4. So, not a lot of positive momentum going into this series this weekend.
Whenever Alabama loses a game, I don't mind losing. It's more of how you lose.
Sure.
Like if you lose like you did Tuesday, I mean, lose Monday and Sunday. That's what bothers me. If a team is just better than you, then that okay, fine. I agree with that. But if you give it away like that, that's what really gets me, because it tells me you're not playing your truly how you can play.
Yeah. Well, they need to play clean this weekend to have any chance to win that series. They can win that series, take 2 out of 3 in Fayetteville. You know, it gets you back to 500 with 2 series to go and a little bit of momentum with Tennessee coming in here. You lose that series this weekend, I don't see a super regional in their future. So, anyway.
I think if we take 2 out of 3, lose the series to Tennessee, take 2 out of 3 from Auburn, that's 13-11 in the SEC. I think that's right. Or something like that. And so, we would have a winning record again. So, that would help. But, like you said, this is big. So, I think the key is starting off winning the first one. Because that's something we've... something we've struggled this year is winning the first one, but and this is some weird times, isn't it? Weird game times this weekend, isn't it?
Let me double check the game times. Hold on, I got it pulled up right here. 6 p.m. tonight. Yeah, 8 p.m. on Saturday. You got a late game, 1 p.m. Sunday. So really the only weird time is tomorrow night. That's a late game, but it's Saturday night. It shouldn't be an issue. 6 tonight, 8 on Saturday, 1 on Sunday. So, well, maybe they'll get it going. Hey, Corey, I got to get to the break, my friend. Let's hope Alabama gets a positive outcome in Fayetteville, and I'll talk to you probably on Monday.
Okay, good talk to you, Gary. Roll Tide.
Thank you, Corey. All right, 9:29. We'll take a break. Come back with Adam Amin from Fox Sports. Talk NBA play-in and playoffs next here on the Gary Harris Show. Los Tarascos has been serving Mexican favorites like burritos, fajitas, and quesadillas since 1999. Their new location is at 4100 Owen Parkway in Northport. And, of course, you can find Los Tarascos in Tuscaloosa at 110 Skyland Boulevard. The bar areas feature big-screen television so you can enjoy your favorite sporting events. Los Tarascos features
10% off all of our other colors. Shop the sale online or visit your neighborhood Sherwin-Williams store. Retail sales only. Some exclusions apply. See store for details.
Life doesn't wait for when your finances are in perfect order. It just happens. But no matter what surprises come your way, Alabama Credit Union will be here to help make it affordable with great personal loans, mortgages, and auto loans. They offer an easy application process and fast decisions so you can stay focused on feeling good about whatever life brings your way. Alabama Credit Union will be here to help make it affordable with great personal loans, mortgages.
Easy to clean and have Skechers exclusive air-cooled memory foam for comfort throughout my shift. Get America's number one selling work shoe at Skechers.com, a Skechers store near you, or wherever work shoes are sold.
As much as Innisfree has evolved, it will always be that place to escape and have a good time. Whether it's for a game day weekend, to reminisce on college days, or to create new memories, if you're looking for a good time, there's only one thing to do. Head to the Free at 1925 University Boulevard. And don't forget about the Lucky Lunch Meat and Three Special. Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. until 2 p.m., get a meat and three vegetables for just $8.49. Or for a lighter appetite, try the Lucky Lunch Soup, Salad, or Sandwich Combo. I'll see you at the Free.
Want to jump into any of the shows? Call Tide 100.9 right now at 205-342-9904.
Will somebody answer that damn phone?
That's 205-342-9904.
Not only is it a really good song for our TGIF edition of the Gary Harris Show, it also puts a smile on our face because when we hear Saturday in the Park, we know that we're going to be talking with one of Chicago's favorite sons, Fox Sports play-by-play announcer Adam Amin. Of course, also does Chicago Bulls games. So he's busy right now. And good morning, Adam. How are you?
Doing well, my friend. Great to hear your voice. Sorry I couldn't make it last week, but I appreciate your flexibility.
Oh, absolutely. Love when you can come on. All right, I think you and I discussed this. I was not a big fan of the play-in when it was first announced. I said, man, this is a gimmick. But I've warmed up to it. I got to admit, you know, it's kind of fun. And but boy, we got the final two play-in games tonight, and you couldn't have worse luck than for the Heat to have their best player, Jimmy Butler, go down before playing the Bulls, and for the Pelicans to have Zion go down before playing Sacramento, a team that they've dominated during the regular season, but that doesn't matter now. Let's start with your Bulls and the Heat tonight down in Miami, but let's be honest, this is not the same Miami team without Jimmy Butler, and Chicago has to be salivating for an opportunity to go down there, get the win, and get into the playoffs. Who do you like tonight?
Yeah, especially after last year, they blew a lead late in the fourth quarter against the same Miami Heat in the same building. I do feel like the Bulls are in good position tonight. I think Vegas still has Miami favored.
They do, 1.5.
I think they get the home court line tonight, which is fine. But the Butler factor is just so huge. I mean, not having Jimmy Butler hurts them at both ends of the floor. And to have a takeover scorer like Miami does with Jimmy not being there is huge. You know, Tyler Hero is going to get a lot of shots more than likely tonight. Maybe we'll see Duncan Robinson after we didn't see him, I think, the other night against Philadelphia. The coach's decision, he's probably going to have to play to at least beef up the rotation a little bit. A lot is going to be on Bam Adebayo in terms of ball handling. So, you know, there are distinct disadvantages that Miami has without Jimmy Butler, just to a floor spacer, a physical defender, a guy who's just fantastically efficient in the mid-range especially, and to just not have that really hurts Miami. And I think that's a huge opportunity for the Bulls. You know, Alex Caruso, who has been banged up all season long, he's had about seven or eight different injury designations this year. We call him Crash Caruso on the air very often because of how physical and how much he's diving on the floor and how, you know, the style with which he plays. He's a game time decision, but if I had to bank on it, I would think he's going to be out there tonight. So I think the Bulls are right in this. I think they have a huge opportunity in front of them to kind of exercise some of the demons from a year ago, and to, in a pretty up and down season and a lot of down this year, to still make the playoffs. Mm-hmm. I think at this point is a pretty nice feat. And I think the Bulls have a real opportunity to do that
tonight. Yeah, I do too. I liked what I saw from them the other night against the Hawks for sure. And in the other final play-in game in the West, you've got Sacktown at New Orleans. Of course, a lot of Bama fans interested here because you've got Herb Jones for New Orleans and then Keon Ellis now playing a really big role for Sacramento. But this, you talk about injuries, man. Zion Williamson was playing incredible against the Lakers and 40 points. The game was tied. He goes down. They lose that game. He's out. And you've got a team in New Orleans that has dominated Sacramento 5-0. I think the average margin of victory is 19. And they're an underdog tonight at home. A 1.5 Sacramento favorite because they don't have Zion. And I'll just ask you point blank, does New Orleans have a shot tonight without him?
I mean, Brandon Ingram is going to have, you know, the game of his life, essentially, it feels like. I think at this point, it's so key. Listen, Sacramento's really talented. Like, I just think they're such a talented team. I love watching them play. And I had to shake my head a little bit because I go, they're playing in an 8-seed game tonight. And then you remember that all 10 teams in the West had at least 46 wins, and it could have been, you know, Sacramento could have easily been in the first round. They could have easily been in a 3-6 matchup. You know, this is a really, really good basketball team. So I feel like it's so incumbent on Brandon Ingram to have a huge game tonight. You know, guys like Jose Alvarado have to be so careful defensively. You know, I think this is a physical time of year in the NBA when you get to the postseason. And I think officials have been calling it pretty physically and swallowing some whistles in the last couple of weeks of the regular season, as they often do. I think it's kind of a preparation for postseason basketball because they want it to be a little more slowed down, a little bit more physical of a game. And I think the Pelicans have to play aggressively and a little bit physically on defense. It was a really solid deflection team. It was a really solid steal team. The Pelicans played solid defense, but again, without Zion, that really hurts them. But they're going to have the most sharp defensive game of the year. I think Herb Jones is going to have to play, you know, as good of a game as he's played all season long in a one and done to try to contain not only De'Aaron Fox, not only Domantas Sabonis, but, you know, they've got real shooters. Mm-hmm. You know, Murray is a fabulous 3-point shooter. They've got depth on that team, and the Pelicans are just hurt without that depth. So it's going to happen. It's going to require really impressive individual efforts tonight for New Orleans to win that game, in my estimation.
You broadcast professional sporting events for a living, so you see it on a regular basis. Do you buy into the jinx theory at all? I mean, you look at Zion. I mean, it's been one thing after another. Then finally, he's healthy. He has a great season. But people were saying, oh, you know, he doesn't play well against LeBron and the Lakers. And then he's having the game of his life. And with 3 minutes to go, he goes down and you know, won't play tonight, really in jeopardy if they do make it into the playoffs. I mean, it just seems like the guy can't catch a break. Is he injury prone to the point of it's just you almost, if you're a New Orleans fan, just can't count on the guy?
I mean, it feels that way. I don't know if that, you know, it's a curse or what. But, I mean, listen, these are things that we talk about when it comes to unique physical talent, right? Like, we've talked about his weight. Other people have talked about his weight. He's had weight, you know,
issues.
Conditions in the contract. You know, he's had issues with his weight in the past. And he worked really, really hard this year. You know, like, he did all the right things. To me, it felt like he did a lot of the right things all season long to be able to play. I mean, what do you play, 70 games this year?
Yes, he played 70, yeah.
Like 70 games. Like, that's a big deal for a guy like that. We say the same thing about Anthony Davis, right? Like, oh, well, he's injury prone and he's never out there when they need him. The guy played almost every game this season. He played like 70, 75 games. So, you know, when these guys are out there, you give them credit for it. I don't think it's a curse. I just think it's bad luck. And part of it might be the physical nature of Zion's game. You know, when he comes out of college or goes into college, even that year at Duke, all of us just looked at him and were like, this guy is a freak of nature. He is just so uniquely built. He's so strong, but he is one of the quickest people in the NBA, you know, relative to his size. You watch him on the floor and he's just so gifted athletically. But with that unique talent, with that unique ability, whatever you want to call it, with that unique ability in one's body, weird things happen because you believe you can contort, you can move, you can flex, you can, you know, bear weight, you can add pressure to different parts of your body to do these incredible physical feats. And sometimes the body's just not made to do those things, or maybe you're not properly prepared to do all those things. But I don't think it's a curse. I think Zion worked really, really hard to get to a point where he's not what we believe to be injury prone, but maybe that's just an issue that's going to pop up because of how uniquely physical he plays and how uniquely built he really is, because he is, when he's at his healthiest, we saw how talented and how scary he is. He had that one rim run at the end of the year, at the end of the regular season. I can't remember which game it was, but it was one of the last three or four games where he went coast to coast at the end of a quarter and just blew past guys. I'm like, this is an incredible athlete. So it's just disappointing. You know, it's sad. I hate seeing that guy out, because when he plays, man, he's one of the most fun players and one of the most joyous players to watch in the NBA.
Yeah, well, I'm going to ask you that question. You had a great answer. Yeah, it just makes you sick if you're an NBA fan for him not to be available. All right, let's get to the playoffs tomorrow. And, man, I tell you, these first-round matchups, there's so many intriguing ones, but we'll stick to tomorrow and won't even really focus on Sunday yet. First of all, the Nuggets and the Lakers, and we know the Nuggets have owned the Lakers, and, you know, Michael Malone, I think, has tweaked LA a little bit, but, you know, you've got LeBron playing like he's 19 in terms of his physicality and really 29 in his prime, and 39, he's a combination of those. The 19-year-old LeBron and the 29-year-old LeBron have come morphed into this mega superstar at 39. He seems to me like he's on a mission. I think the Lakers want the Nuggets, wanting them and beating them, two different things, but boy, what a great first-round series to have Los Angeles and Denver pitted against each other.
I mean, Jokic and Davis and LeBron all on the floor together. Jamal Murray, a healthy Jamal Murray on the floor. Once again, it's one of the great matchups, I think. And again, there's not really a lot of bad matchups in the West because of how deep the conference was, right? So like we said, every team had at least 46 wins that made the postseason this year. So really impressive stuff. I think Jamal Murray is so important to what that Denver team does because, you know, they're not as deep this year as they were a year ago. Like, guys like Bruce Brown, who made really key plays, the Jeff Greens of the world that were so steady come playoff time, they're not as deep as they were. But that puts a little bit more weight on the stars of this series. Jokic is going to – I'm not worried about Jokic. Jokic is going to do exactly what Jokic has done for the last three seasons when he's been the MVP. Like, it's just going to be steady and good, and he's going to – drop your jaw a couple times during the series with a pass that he makes, or he's going to take some wild three that looks ridiculous and he's going to make it from 30 feet because he's done that a couple of times this year. You know, I think so much is incumbent on guys like Porter and Murray to elevate their games because there's going to be so much attention paid to Jokic. For the Lakers, you know, we just talked about Anthony Davis. This is as healthy as I think we've seen him in a long time. He has to play physically. They got to get him looks on the three-point line. You know, I know Denver's going to try to minimize how many looks he gets on the perimeter. You know, he likes dragging defenders out of the paint. You know, Denver's a really good help defense, but typically you're not playing guys like Anthony Davis who have the ability to force you to step out further, maybe 2 or 3 feet further than you really want to. And those 2 or 3 feet for somebody like LeBron James to have that type of floor space for drives, for, you know, the blow-bys, you know, these typical things that we've seen from LeBron. And like you said, age 39 season playing the way he is just incredible. The floor spacing in this series is so crucial. So can they defend Anthony Davis? Can Davis have good shooting nights over the course of this series? Because if he does, then you're looking at a real series. If not, then maybe this is a a five-game series with a couple of close games and Denver's walking out of there. But I think the floor spacing in this series is going to determine it. And if the Lakers have the floor space for LeBron to do what he wants to do on drives and drive and kick game and drive and cut and pass game, then the Lakers are really going to be in this thing, and it's going to be a test for Denver defensively.
Yeah, it's going to be fun. Phoenix and Minnesota, another series that just has all kinds of storylines. The T-Wolves have had a great year. But why do I feel like that Phoenix, even though it's been an up-and-down season, I almost feel like in my mind Phoenix is the favorite here. There's so much pressure on Durant to lead this team to something, and I just think that I hate to say flip a switch, because that's usually never happens, but I think this Phoenix team's got a lot more in them than what they've shown, and I think they're going to win this series against Minnesota.
That's interesting. I agree with you. I think there is a lot more than what we've seen for Phoenix, right? They're just not – they shouldn't be this way, it feels
right.
Like. But they've got to have help. We talk so much about the big three for them, right, this year with Beal and Booker and Durant. And there was so much on those guys. But I think role players in this series are going to be so crucial. I look at Naz Reid for Minnesota. Mm-hmm. I look at Grayson Allen for Phoenix. Allen has had such a fabulous three-point shooting season. He's really found a home in Phoenix. They signed him to an extension for a reason. He's going to have a very good series shooting the basketball because Minnesota is so good defensively. I think they're the top-ranked defense, or I think they finished number one in both efficiency and scoring, or certainly in the top three in both those categories. But I saw them late in the regular season. Bulls actually played very well against them, and part of the reason was their shooting. And Grayson Allen can shoot a team into a series and knock a team out. He did that against Chicago a couple of years ago when he was with Milwaukee. He had some of the best games of his playoff career in that series. And to stretch defenses, we were just talking about that with Denver. You have to stretch the defense of Minnesota. They're so good on the interior, and I think their on-ball defense is as good as any team in the NBA. I think Anthony Edwards is an absolute dog. Like, just the way he plays physically, how he gets into passing lanes. Conley is so crafty at the guard position. I know what the big three are capable of. I think it's really incumbent on the guys like Jusuf Nurkić and Grayson Allen to have good series. And Allen in particular has to shoot the basketball well, because that's the only way you force a defense like Minnesota that has multiple bigs, that has Rudy Gobert, arguably the best defensive player of this generation, certainly one of the five best of this generation, in my estimation. He's waiting back to block shots. But how do you open up floor space? The same thing we just talked about with the Lakers. You have to make shots. You have to force this defense out. And that's why I still feel like Minnesota is the favorite in this series. I think they're probably the better team. But I think the talent of Phoenix can win them a series. So I don't think it's a walk away. I think that might actually be one of the better series in the first round. I don't know if I would pick Phoenix as you were bold enough to do, Gary, but I don't think it's that bold of a prediction either. I think it's a perfectly reasonable way to think about this series, but I feel like I like Minnesota going in a deep series, maybe six or seven games.
Talking NBA playoffs with Adam Amin from Fox Sports. All right, tomorrow in the East, Orlando-Cleveland, it's a big series for you guys, but I'm not going to talk about it. But we are going to talk about the Knicks and the Sixers, because if you're a classic NBA fan, the Knicks at the Garden taking on either Boston or Philadelphia doesn't get any better than this, and they get the Sixers, and Embiid is back. I don't know, again, how close he is to 100%, but he's playing, and the Knicks have finished the season strong. Brunson has been, phenomenal. I knew the guy was a pretty good player. I never dreamed he would rise to the level that he's risen to, but I feel like there's a lot of pressure on the Knicks here in this series. Philadelphia, you could say, too, going into the season, where it was an NBA contender, but with the injuries and so forth, I think if the Knicks don't win this series, man, Thibodeau and that team and that fan base, it's going to be rough.
Yeah, I mean, it'll be rough no matter what when you're the two seed, but I feel like this is the one of the few series in the East that mirrors more of the West.
Yeah.
Because Philadelphia is not a 7 seed. They are absolutely not a 7 seed. Before Embiid got hurt, I thought they were the second best team in the conference, right behind Boston.
Right.
And the fact is that since Embiid has come back, they have been as good as any team in the NBA. Tyrese Maxey has found himself. Batum, what a signing, you know, to bring him in. I think it was part of the trade, I should say. I think it was the part of the Harden deal. But, you know, what a pickup for them. You know, a classic 3-and-D guy who at times has been put on the scrap heap, you know, and but continuously delivers. I think the depth of Philadelphia has gotten them to this point. You know, I know they struggled after Embiid got hurt. They've been as good as any team in the league. And I don't know if New York has a matchup for him. You know, Isaiah Hartenstein is a really good big. I really like how he plays. He's not fast enough to compete with Embiid, and I don't think he's comfortable playing beyond 10 feet away from the rim. And Embiid loves to operate in multiple spots on the floor. He loves to take threes. He can back you down in the high post. He loves operating on the block. And that's where Hartenstein's at his best, on the block. But Embiid being out on the perimeter is going to hurt them. Mitchell Robinson, their backup big, didn't look like himself. Because he missed 50 games, he had an ankle injury, and then he came back late in the year and was struggling, and he didn't look like he was in game shape. I don't know how much of a factor he's going to be. You know, are they going to turn to Jericho Sims to try to guard Joel Embiid? Are they going to turn to Precious Achiuwa, who's undersized, to try to guard Embiid? Like, that's a big question to me. Brunson, you mentioned it. Gosh, Jalen Brunson, what a year! I think he won't win. He should absolutely garner MVP votes. He won't win and he shouldn't, but he should get votes. And if you were to tell me that you think Brunson should be on the first team, All-NBA over somebody like Jason Tatum, I would let you make that argument and probably convince, because he's been that good this season. I think he can carry a team, but is the workload, you know, going to be those guys are prepared for the workload. You know, they're prepared to play 40, 43 minutes. Hart and DiVincenzo and Brunson, they're prepared to play all those minutes. But I don't know what their answer is going to be for Joel Embiid. And if Embiid has a big series, then we're looking at a real potential for an upset, even though I don't think it's necessarily fair to call it an upset with how good Philadelphia was before the Embiid injury.
All right, we still got a couple minutes, so I'm going to squeeze in a little bit on Sunday. A little bit quicker analysis, Adam, please. But Milwaukee without Giannis against the Pacers in game one. Indiana actually is favored now in talking again about injuries and how big they are. And game ones are critical. So, you know, Milwaukee at home, does this feel like, you know, if they don't win this game that they're in trouble?
I do think they're in trouble. I think Indiana's gotten better defensively in the second half of the year. And I think, you know, they're the highest pace and highest scoring team, or certainly one of the highest scoring teams in the league. And one thing that Milwaukee loves to do in playoff time is grind you down. And I just don't know if they're capable of doing that without Giannis, who's been a defensive player of the year. He's been one of the better defenders in the NBA. They're not as good defensively this year as they were last year when they had Jrue Holiday as their lead guard. Now it's Damian Lillard, who is, you know, pretty porous defensively, I would say, at times. So, yeah, no, Milwaukee's in real trouble without Giannis. If Giannis is back, you know, if they lose a game or two, but they get Giannis back, I think they make that a series. But if Giannis is out for a significant portion of time, if he misses three games, I mean, that's what happened to them in that Miami series last year. When Giannis got hurt, that's when they ended up losing to an 8 seed. So, without Giannis, that's a major impact because of how quickly Indiana moves the ball and how quickly they can score against you. And Milwaukee's not as good defensively, not nearly as good defensively without Giannis.
And Adam, from just a pure entertainment standpoint, there might not be a better first-round series than Dallas and the Clippers.
Some of the most breathtaking individual talent in the league on one floor between Doncic and Kyrie, and how well I think the Clippers have played. I really am rooting for Paul George. I think he's had a great year. I think he's learned so much just being next to Kawhi Leonard and next to James Harden. I give Harden a lot of credit for how he's adapted to the style of play in LA and the kind of backseat he's taken. I think Westbrook has made the most of his role. He says he's the best bench player in the NBA, and he's got a great case for it. I think that's some of the best individual guard talent in the NBA, guard and wing talent on the floor in one series. That's going to be the one that I'm going to be probably the most intrigued by in the West.
All right, Adam, one final question. NFL, your Bears are going to take Caleb Williams, number one, but they got the 9 pick as well in the first round. Do they go receiver to pair with him? Do they look at offensive tackle? Could they look at an edge rusher like Dallas Turner from Alabama to pair with Sweat? What do you think the Bears do at number 9?
I would love to see them go either edge rusher or tackle. I think those were the weak spots. You know, the defense for the Bears got significantly better when Montez Sweat got there, just to have some presence off the edge. I think I don't think they need a receiver necessarily, and I don't think they should have to use the number nine pick to get a receiver unless you feel like Rome Odunze is out there and you really believe that that's the next guy. Because I think he's I don't think he's as good as Marvin Harrison Jr. I don't think anybody's as good as Marvin Harrison Jr., but Rome is right up there as one of the best receivers in the draft. But I would love to see them bulk up the offensive line, especially if Caleb Williams, you're making all this investment. You got rid of Justin Fields. You brought in receivers. You worked this hard to have a great situation for a number one pick and a rookie quarterback. Let's make sure he's protected. And I think that's the biggest key for this Bears team in general, if they're trying to turn over a new leaf with how they develop their quarterbacks going forward.
Adam, love picking your brain, man. Great analysis on the NBA playoffs. Appreciate it. And are you doing the Bulls for local TV tonight?
Not tonight. It's national only. It'll be on ESPN. Okay. They win, they'll play the Celtics on ABC on Sunday, and then we'll pick it up in Boston next week if they make that first-round series.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thanks, Gary.
All right, we're going to take a break, come back and wrap up this first hour right after this.
If you haven't already, you've got to try Tuscaloosa's unique breakfast, brunch, and lunch concept. Brick and Spoon, downtown Tuscaloosa, Timberson Square. It's fresh food with a Cajun flair featuring a full bar with build-your-own Bloody Marys and mimosas. Open daily, 7 a.m. until 2 p.m. Available for after hours of
house-made queso, sweet vinaigrette dressing, and spicy Cajun sauce. And check out our breakfast catering menu. Who's Q and Brew is open 7 days a week. We're located at 1825 McFarland Boulevard North in the Northridge Center.
Tuscaloosa's Old Colony Golf Course is an 18-hole championship layout designed by 1976 U.S. Open champion Jerry Pate. Director of Golf John Gray and fitting specialist Bob Montgomery are PGA certified. Mike Shivitz is the head professional and director of the Tuscaloosa Junior Golf Program. Call today to secure a tee time.
Boulevard West, Krispy Kreme is open 7 days a week. To see our complete donut, coffee, and espresso menu, visit our website at KrispyKremeTuscaloosa.com. Krispy Kreme, hot now and anytime. Since 2011, Billy's Sports Grill, located on Main Avenue in historic downtown Northport, has been serving their legendary signature chicken sandwich, award-winning wings, and handcrafted cocktails. Billy's is also the spot to watch all your favorite sporting events with big-screen, high-definition television, both dining rooms, at the bar, and outside on the beautiful patio. Come by and say hello to Kim and Lisa, the Billy's management dream team. Billy's, good food, good friends, and good time.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
The weather stays warm today, mostly cloudy through tonight. A few scattered showers or thunderstorms possible. The high today, 84. Tonight's low, 60. Tomorrow, mostly cloudy. A few passing showers are likely during the day. The high, 74. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 70 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
You're listening to The Gary Harris Show.
Goal line in, touchdown, Alabama!
On your home for Alabama sports.
Tide 100.9.
And streaming on the Tide 100.9 app.
Oh, yeah, that Friday first hour getaway song, one of my favorites, The Cure. Friday, I'm in love. All we got to do is to come back in and tell you that we're getting out of this first hour. It's been brought to you by Alabama Credit Union. Thanks to First Domain Condominiums for the hotline. Hour number two is coming up. Brent Pritchard with the Auburn Report at 10:30, plus our Krispy Kreme donuts for a year and T-shirt giveaway. And we will take phone calls as well. So another hour of The Gary Harris Show is on the way. Robert Smith and The Cure, get us out of here on this TGIF edition.
Five 24/7. You'll find road and utility crews, tow trucks, law enforcement, and first responders working along Alabama's roadway.
We're making improvements and helping our communities stay connected.
We're working hard to make sure you're safe on the road. Now we need your help to make sure we're safe too.
Alabama's move over law requires you to move over a lane when you see flashing lights on the roadside.
After it.
Limited time discount available online only while supplies last. Taxes extra. New customers only. Must activate the device within 30 days to avoid paying full price. Offer subject to change.
As much as Innisfree has evolved, it will always be that place to escape and have a good time. Whether it's for a game day weekend, to reminisce on college days, or to create new memories, if you're looking for a good time, there's only one thing to do. Head to the Free at 1925 University Boulevard. And don't forget about the Lucky Lunch Meat and Three Special. Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. until 2 p.m., get a meat and three vegetables for just $8.49. Or for a lighter appetite, try the Lucky Lunch soup, salad, or sandwich combo. I'll see you at the Free.
My caretaker was very rough with me,
I thought they did it because I wasn't moving fast enough.
Elder abuse is a crime, and together we can stop it. If you or someone you know has been abused, neglected, or exploited, call the Adult Abuse Hotline at 1-800-458-7214. That's 1-800-458-7214. Sponsored by the Alabama Department of Human Resources, the Department of Justice, ADECA grant number 18-VA-VS-050, the ABA, and this station.
Life doesn't wait for when your finances are in perfect order. It just happens. But no matter what surprises come your way, Alabama Credit Union will be here to help make it affordable with great personal loans, mortgages, and auto loans. They offer an easy application process and fast decisions so you can stay focused on feeling good about whatever life brings your way. Alabama Credit Union will be here to help make it affordable with great personal loans, mortgages, and auto loans. Alabama Credit Union, loans for real life. Visit alabamacu.com to learn more. Some rules and restrictions apply. See if you're eligible for membership, then join today and feel good about your money.
It's the Tide 100.9 30K Workday Payday.
Woo!
Win cash every weekday, 8 to 5. Here's this hour's cash code.
477. Again, that's 477. The code is 477.
Enter that code now on the Tide 100.9 app. Click on the 30K payday button and enter the code for a chance to win $30,000. From the Fox Sports studios in Los Angeles, here's Monsi Bolaños.
Three-time Cy Young Award winner Justin Verlander is set to make his season debut for the Astros today as they take on the Nationals. He started the season on the injured list with inflammation in his right shoulder. The battle for the eight seeds in the NBA playoffs tips off later today. It all starts in the East as the Heat will be hosting the Bulls, but Miami will be without Jimmy Butler, who is out for an indefinite period of time due to an MCL injury that he suffered during a play-in tournament loss to the 76ers. Winner will face the Celtics in the first round of the playoffs. Out of the West, the Pelicans will be hosting the Kings, but New Orleans will be without their star Zion Williamson due to a hamstring injury that he suffered during a play-in loss to the Lakers. Winner will face the Oklahoma City Thunder in the first round of the playoffs. And in college hoops, UConn freshman guard Stephon Castle is entering the 2024 NBA draft.
Now, this hour's West Alabama real-time news update from the Tuscaloosa Thread Newsroom.
Roughly 5,000 people who work at the Mercedes-Benz U.S. International plant in Tuscaloosa County will vote on whether to join the United Auto Workers Union during a week-long period next month. For more details, be sure to tap the free Tuscaloosa Thread app. Fans of Golden Fried Chicken Fingers are happy as Tuscaloosa's third Guthrie's is now open in its former location on Skyland Boulevard. And the Tuscaloosa chapter of the Lynx presents a young artist showcase this Sunday. For details about the event, tap our free Tuscaloosa Thread app.
Get 24/7 local news coverage and sports updates when you download the free Tuscaloosa Thread app and sign up for twice daily email newsletters. The Gary Harris Show. You see him host Tider Insider TV, Crimson Tide Kickoff, play-by-play for Alabama sports, and sports director for WVUA 23. It's time for The Gary Harris Show on your home for Alabama sports. Tide 100.9 and streaming on the Tide 100.9 app.
All right, here we go. Hour number two of The Gary Harris Show, the TGIF edition. Rocking and rolling. Good first hour. Listen, I love Adam Amin. I think he's outstanding, so talented. And, you know, we don't talk NBA that often. So going into the playoffs, I didn't think there was anything wrong with having an NBA segment. And I think even casual sports fans who don't pay much attention to the NBA during the regular season enjoy the playoffs. And like I said, Justin, how do you feel about it? At first, when I saw play-in, I'm like, you know, to play off of Allen Iverson with playoffs. You talking about? I was like, play-in? You're talking about a play-in? You play 82 games to play a play-in? But I've warmed up to it, man. It's pretty exciting that you've got a chance to get in the playoffs, but you're not actually in them. But it's even more pressure than the playoffs, because the playoffs, at least you're going, you know, 4 out of 7. Yeah. In this case, you're either going to one loss or two losses and you're out. So it's been pretty cool. And we got the final two games tonight.
It's the same kind of energy and excitement as the play-in games for the NCAA tournament. Those games are typically schools that we don't follow, but man, their chance to get in and be part of the tournament makes it interesting, makes it fun.
Yeah. So anyway, people that know me know I'm a bigger NBA fan than a lot of people in this part of the country. So enjoy talking NBA playoffs with Adam Amin. This hour of the Gary Harris Show is brought to you by Patterson Comer Attorneys at Law. Patterson Comer is dedicated to serving our clients. Integrity and excellence are the driving force behind the firm and its staff. Clients and prospective clients are treated with respect and care, and that's important. Paul Patterson is in Tuscaloosa at 205-345-1000. Mike Comer's in Northport, 205-759-3939. So if you need legal assistance, particularly if you've been in an automobile accident, dealing with a personal injury, I mean, anything like that, call them right away. And if you live in West Alabama, you need to call Patterson Comer when you need an attorney. Again, Paul Patterson in Tuscaloosa at 205-345-1000. Mike Comer's in Northport at 205-759-3939. Feet on the ground right here in West Alabama. I think that's important. And remember, the commitment to serve our clients does not stop at the end of the workday. We're available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. PattersonComerLawFirm.com.
No representation is made that the quality of legal services to be performed is greater than the quality of services performed by other lawyers.
All right, let's go. Corey called in earlier about Alabama softball, Justin, and I'm going to bring this up because somebody shot me a message, and they weren't rude about it. Somebody that I know, she's a huge softball fan, and she's listening, and she said that she thought I was being a little rough on the softball team. I don't think so. I didn't mean it that way. So I hope that's not the way I came across. I'm trying to be objective and I'm trying to be honest. And based on what we've seen, 15 games into the conference schedule with 9 more games to go, I think Alabama's going to have to play better to win enough games down the stretch to be in position to host a super regional if they host a regional, which I'm sure they will. And if they win the regional, to be in position to host supers. I don't think that's an unfair statement. And again, you can't throw out the Ole Miss series. It counts. Ole Miss is an SEC team. But if you take away that 3-game sweep, Justin, against Ole Miss, which they needed and they got, and remember I told you and I told our listeners, they're going to sweep Ole Miss. I flat out called it. If you take that away, they've lost every SEC series they've played. They haven't won a single SEC series outside of Ole Miss. Okay, they lost 2 of 3 at Georgia. They lost 2 of 3 at Kentucky. Swept Ole Miss. Lost 2 of 3 against A&M. And they lost 2 of 3 at home against Florida, which started SEC play. So I'm just looking at this team and looking at where they're at and where they want to go, and they're going to have to play better. It's just that simple. They're going to have to play better. I mean, they've won one SEC series. So if I'm being tough on them by pointing out the facts, then I'm just going to have to live with it. And again, Ole Miss counts. And thank goodness they swept that series. Because think of where they would be if they had just even won 2 of 3. I mean, they haven't won. And again, let this sink in for a minute. This is Alabama softball. This is one of the most proud programs, not just in the SEC, but in the country. And that's what we're going to do our trivia tie-in for our Krispy Kreme donuts giveaway in the next segment. I'm going to tell you how many times Alabama has been to the World Series, and that'll be the number caller that we take. But this is one of the proudest programs in the country. And to have lost every series in the conference other than one, that's not good softball, Justin. I'm sorry.
I don't think a lot of fans realize the importance and I don't want to say desperation, but the timeliness of this. We're adding the number one. It's been a while since I've looked at the rankings, but we're adding the number one and number two teams, at least previously, Oklahoma and Texas to this conference. If Alabama wants to consistently host these regionals and be contenders and make it to the World Series, you have to step up and win more of these games.
And you got to recruit better. It's just or with portal, whatever. Again, and this is my opinion. I think Alabama, from a talent standpoint, is at a deficit. as compared to the top teams in this league. And there's no way they're as talented as Oklahoma and Texas. So you're right. I mean, now, can they win the series at Arkansas? I think they can. And everybody always wants me to make predictions. And I've been pretty good at making these predictions so far this year with Bama softball. I've had a pretty good buzz, pretty good feel for them. I think they're going to win the series this weekend. I think they're going to take 2 of 3. I do. I think they're going to win 2 of 3 in Fayetteville, which is going to give them a little momentum and get them, you know, back to 500. So we'll see. But I think they're going to win the series. So that's my prediction. Alabama wins 2 of 3. So I haven't given up on them by any means. I'm picking them to win a road series. But I do think you have to be objective. And that's not being harsh. That's just telling the truth. All right, as far as baseball is concerned, I don't like doubleheaders. I just think both teams have to play them. I get it. And I do think if you're playing a doubleheader, you're probably better off playing it at home. But I would have preferred that game to be played last night. But you got Ferone going in game. I assume Ferone will go in game one. I don't know. Maybe they'll go Hess now. Because Hess was scheduled to pitch on Friday. That's a good question. You know, the rotation was going to be Ferone, Hess, Adams. Greg Ferone, Ben Hess, Zane Adams. But now, with two games today, do you run Hess out there for game one of the doubleheader and then pitch Ferone in game two? Or do you stay with Ferone in game one and pitch Hess in game two? I don't know yet. I'll check, because usually Alabama puts out on Twitter, they'll put out their lineup card. So I'll check and see. But this is a huge series for Alabama baseball, too. Alabama baseball is in a pretty good spot right now.
Yeah, Gary, I'm looking at the lineup card here. They're going to go with Ferone.
Okay, so they're going to stay with Ferone in game. So you got the lineup card. All right, Ferone's going to pitch game one. Hess will pitch game two. But this is a series at home. It's a chance to make another statement against the number one team. You go on the road for back-to-back series after this. Although I'll tell you this, going on the road to Oxford and Starkville is not as daunting as it once was. Alabama's got a chance, I think, to win both those series on the road. But, boy, if you could get 2 out of 3 against A&M on the heels of taking 2 out of 3 against Arkansas would be huge for Alabama baseball. And I like Alabama baseball chances of getting 2 of 3. I do. That's why, though, when you play a doubleheader, you know, you're going to know right off the bat, I mean, where this series stands, 2 days, 3 games. So, you know, you certainly want to do no worse than split today and give Adams an opportunity to win the series for you tomorrow. But, boy, wouldn't it be sweet if Alabama took both ends of this doubleheader? My gosh, that would be awesome. All right, it's 10:13 here on the Gary Harris Show. When we come back on the other side, get ready. We're going to do the way we've been doing it on the Krispy Kreme donuts is you don't have to answer a trivia question. I just give you a trivia fact, and today it's going to be on Alabama softball. And then whatever the answer is, that number is the caller that we're going to take. So we're going to do the Krispy Kreme donuts T-shirt giveaway in the next segment. And also, once we get through with that, would welcome your phone calls on the Krispy Kreme donuts hotline at 205-342-9904. All right. Also, in the next segment, I'm going to talk Bama basketball with the portal and NIL and where Alabama stands in regards to adding players. We'll have an update. Aiden Holloway, the former Auburn point guard, it looks promising that he might wind up playing here at Alabama, the old Auburn to Alabama. Also, we'll have the latest, too, on the portal as far as the Crimson Tide coming and going with men's basketball. So we'll do all that in the next segment. Before we get to the break, I do want to tell you the YMCA of Tuscaloosa is just a phenomenal, phenomenal facility. I talk about it every day, and why not? I love being a member. I love working out there. I'm going to be working out there today, in fact, and it's just a great place not only to get fit, but to meet people. It's a community of people that are like-minded, all they're trying to better themselves. And I would encourage you, if you've hit the wall a little bit with your workouts, don't be embarrassed to try personal training. Really, I do it. I use personal trainers. It'll get you over the hump. Bennett Elmore, Riley Strickland, and Michael Johnson, the personal trainers at the YMCA, are outstanding. And they have sessions for individuals, duo sessions. They have 30-minute sessions. They have 60-minute sessions. They're very, very reasonably priced, and they will help you go where you have not been able to go before in terms of your training. Consider personal training from the YMCA, 2300 13th Street, YMCATuscaloosa.org. All right, we'll be back with our Krispy Kreme Donuts t-shirt and donuts giveaway right after this. Since 2011, Billy's Sports Grill, located on Main Avenue in historic downtown Northport, has been serving their legendary signature chicken sandwich, award-winning wings, and handcrafted cocktails. Billy's is also the spot to watch all your favorite sporting events with big-screen, high-definition televisions, both dining rooms, at the bar, and outside.
I got you!
Silk almond milk.
With calcium, vitamins A, D, and E.
Feel plenty good.
Los Tarascos has been serving Mexican favorites like burritos, fajitas, and quesadillas since 1999. Their new location is at 4100 Owen Parkway in Northport. And, of course, you can find Los Tarascos in Tuscaloosa at 110 Skyland Boulevard. The bar areas feature big-screen television so you can enjoy your favorite sporting events. Los Tarascos features daily happy hour specials.
Get after it!
Limited time discount available online only, while supplies last. Taxes extra. New customers only. Must activate the device within 30 days to avoid paying full price. Offer subject to change.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
The weather stays warm today, mostly cloudy through tonight. A few scattered showers or thunderstorms possible. A high today, 84. Tonight's low, 60. Tomorrow, mostly cloudy. A few passing showers are likely during the day. The high, 74. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 70 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
The best place for your high school football coverage is right here on Tide 100.9 and online on Tide100.9.com.
Talking about the YMCA, so we're going to come back with the Village People for our TGIF edition. YMCA, and let's go ahead and do our Krispy Kreme Donuts giveaway. We're going to give away Krispy Kreme Donuts for a year. It's a punch card. You take it in, and they punch that month, and you got free donuts for a year, 12 months. And also, I will say this, we're down to medium only t-shirts. We've given away all our XLs and our 2XLs. So if you don't wear medium, then you can give it to your wife or your daughter, your son. You know, if you, and if you're, listen, these are pretty big t-shirts now. So if you're a slender guy, you can probably wear a medium, but we don't have anything but mediums left. So I'm going to tell you that. But if you can't wear a medium, you can give it to somebody else. But I know the donuts for a year, everybody can use. So, all right, we're going to do a little trivia without you having to answer the question. I just give the answer and then we take that number caller. Since we've been talking a lot about Bama softball, the trivia is Alabama has been to the Women's College World Series 14 times. 14, that's a lot. First time in 2000. Last time was last year, 2023. They also went in 2003, 2005, 2006, 2008, 2009, 2011, 2012, when they won it all, 2014, 2015, 2016, 2019, and 2021. So we are going to take the 14th caller right now on the Krispy Kreme Donuts hotline at 205-342-9904. That's 205-342-9904. One more time, 205-342-9904. If you're the 14th caller right now on the Krispy Kreme Donuts hotline at 205-342-9904, you're going to win Krispy Kreme Donuts for a year and a Krispy Kreme Donuts t-shirt. So Justin will be taking that, and as soon as we get the winner, we'll pass it along, and we'll get you that card and your t-shirt. All right, I'm going to talk a little bit of Bama basketball right now while we're getting our callers taken care of. And Alabama, of course, as we've well documented, five players from the 2024 Final Four team are in the portal. Okay? Nick Pringle, Sam Walters, Ryland Griffin, Chris Parker, and Davin Cosby. All right. Two players are coming in from the portal. And there are probably going to be more that come in for the portal. There's a lot of discussion right now about Aiden Holloway, who is a guy that was a McDonald's All-American, a five-star out of high school that signed with Auburn. And quite honestly, the expectation was that he was going to be a dynamic player for the Auburn Tigers as a point guard, a scoring point guard. It did not really happen. And nobody seems to really know why. Aiden Holloway's from Charlotte, North Carolina, but he went to Prolific Prep out in Napa, California, where two Alabama signees played that are coming in for next season, Reed and Sherrell. He is, I feel like, going to wind up committing to Alabama. I just get that. I get that buzz that Aiden Holloway is going to wind up committing to Alabama. And so you go from Auburn to Alabama. And we're going to see more of this. And now, you know, Alabama to Auburn. We've got Antonio Kite, the defensive back from Anniston, who went to the portal football-wise and played at Alabama last year. He'll be playing at Auburn next year. You're going to see more of this. So it's not going to be as uncommon as it once was. But he's a guy that, again, why it didn't, and I'll ask Brett Pritchard about it when we have him on for the Auburn Report, why it did not click for Aiden Holloway the way everyone felt like it would, I don't know. I really don't. But he is a very talented guy as a 6'1 scoring point guard. Now, he still averaged 7.3 points, 1.5 rebounds, and 2.7 assists last season. So it wasn't like, you know, he didn't play. He played a lot. And then down the stretch didn't play as much. The disappointing thing was he shot 31.8% from the field. He did shoot 77.4% from the free throw line. But he is a guy who seemed to lose his confidence down the stretch. But Nate Oates and company, if he chooses Alabama, might wind up helping him get his confidence back. Because I think the young man can really play. As far as other possibilities, obviously the big center from Rutgers is a guy that Alabama wants. Clifford Omori.
Pronounced Omori.
Omori. Clifford Omori. 6'11", we thought would be in Tuscaloosa this weekend for a visit. But Omori is going to be at Georgetown this weekend. And it looks as though he's going to try to get a visit into Alabama next weekend. I would rather seen him have gone ahead and come to Alabama this weekend, because while he's at Georgetown, you don't know what might happen there. This is a guy Alabama wants. 6'11", rim protector that can also score and obviously rebound. Because this roster is going to look a lot different for Alabama men's basketball than it did last year. Just like the roster this past season looked a lot different than the year before. That's where we're at. But I think and trust, I think that Nate Oates understands as well as any coach how to work the portal. And I trust that he does, because I think he is looking at reshaping this roster, even though they're coming off a Final Four. And as I've said before, I like Sam Walters. I like him. I think he's a good player. Obviously, Ryland Griffin's a guy that they would have liked to have had back. Nick Pringle really played strong down the stretch. But they had issues with him all season. Would I have liked to have seen Pringle come back? Maybe. But he's not. So it's going to be interesting to see this Alabama basketball roster come to fruition. But I feel strongly that Holloway is a guy that could help Alabama. And I wouldn't be shocked, Justin, if we hear something on him very soon. Wouldn't be shocked if, you know, if he's going to go to Alabama, wouldn't be shocked if we heard something possibly sometime this evening, you know. So he's been here for a visit, and we'll keep you abreast of that. And we'll get Brett Pritchard's opinion on Aiden Holloway and why it didn't work out better at Auburn in the next segment on the Auburn Report. All right, what's Krispy Kreme Donuts? Who's our winner?
Michael P. is our winner.
All right, Michael P., I'll be in touch with you, and we'll get you hooked up with your Krispy Kreme punch card donuts for a year and that T-shirt. So look forward to that. All right, we're going to get to the break. Before we do, though, I was over at Who's Q and Brew last night after the early news, after the baseball game got postponed, and it was burger night, which is unbelievable on Thursday nights. $5 burgers and $1 off draft beers, 4 p.m. to close. Unbelievable special. But they got specials every day for lunch, too. And the lunch specials include drink and tax. And today is Friday, so they've got chicken salad or pimento cheese sandwich with a side and drink for just $10. How about that? Daily lunch specials, evening specials, live music on Monday nights, 17 TVs, and the only BuzzTime trivia location in town.
24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Visit PattersonComerLawFirm.com.
No representations made that legal services provided by Patterson Comer is greater than any other legal services performed by any other lawyer.
Serving part-time in the Army National Guard has led to a lot of firsts for me. It paid for me to be the first person in my family to go to school. That education got me to the first day at my dream job, which I can still hold while I serve part-time. That job and the home loan benefits I got from the Army National Guard helped me buy my first house. I also know that I will be one of the first to respond if my community ever needs me.
Sponsored by the Alabama Army National Guard. Aired by the Alabama Broadcasters Association and this station.
Tuscaloosa's Old Colony Golf Course is an 18-hole championship layout designed by 1976 U.S. Open champion Jerry Pate. Director of Golf John Gray and fitting specialist Bob Montgomery are PGA certified. Mike Shivitz is the head professional and director of the Tuscaloosa Junior Golf Program. Call today to secure a tee time at the Tuscaloosa Championship Golf Course. Everyone can play. 205-562-3201. Old Colony is operated by Para.
Are you receiving unemployment? Your benefits could be at risk. Here's how you can protect yourself and your benefits. Never respond to mail notifying you of a false claim in your name. Never answer a text message asking you to verify your account. And only respond to official Alabama Department of Labor's social media pages. Report fraud at labor.alabama.gov/fraud. Brought to you by the Alabama Department of Labor, ABA, and the station. The Alabama Department of Labor is an equal opportunity employer program. Auxiliary aids and services available upon request to individuals with disabilities. Dial 711 for TTY accessibility.
If you haven't already, you've got to try Tuscaloosa's unique breakfast, brunch, and lunch concept. Brick and Spoon, downtown Tuscaloosa, Timberson Square. It's fresh food with a Cajun flair featuring a full bar with build-your-own Bloody Marys and mimosas. Open daily, 7 a.m. until 2 p.m. Available for after-hours events, rehearsal dinners, receptions, and birthdays. They offer brunch and lunch catering. Call Brick and Spoon at 205-345-5551 for more information.
Covering University of Alabama sports, as well as the national and local scene as well. The Gary Harris Show, only on Tide 100.9 and streaming on the Tide 100.9 app.
Welcome back into the Gary Harris Show, and it's time for the Auburn Report with Brett Pritchard from the Auburn Blitz, who joins us on Fridays on the TGIF edition to break down all things Auburn Tigers. Hey, Brett, good morning.
Hey, Gary, what's up, buddy?
Hey, man, good to have you. And the big news for Auburn this week is men's basketball. And you and I have kidded about this. I just never know anymore when somebody's eligibility runs out. I mean, I believe it when I see it. But Janai Broome is a guy who last year Auburn fans worried might go into the draft. He came back and then had a phenomenal season this year, and you kind of assume, well, he's ready to move on now and try his hand in the NBA. Not so fast, my friends. He's going to run it back with Auburn for another year. Of course, obviously, NIL is a factor in that, but you know, when you're talking about recruiting and getting players in, nothing I think is better than when you're able to hang on to one of your proven best players, and Auburn's doing that with Janai Broome. How big a hit is this for the Tigers' basketball fortunes for next year? I mean, when I say hit, I mean positive, not negative in this case, yeah.
No. It's the biggest. It's the biggest positive. I mean, there's no question about it. I mean, you got a guy that returns that's as talented as he is, and definitely had his shot last year. You know, Auburn had to wait through the summer to just, you know, to finally figure out if he was coming back or not. You know, he's having such a good summer in the NBA combine and in the camps that it was really looking like he was going to, you know, possibly be drafted and may even make it into that first round. But decided to forego that and come back and had a great year this past year. You know, I don't think anybody, after coming out of the summer last year, coming back one more year, I think everybody felt like the whole year this was it for Janai Broome. I mean, and he was having another good year and really no option. But, you know, I'm going to tell you something, Gary. NIL has just changed the game. We talk about it all the time. I'm sick of it, really, talking about it. Right. It seems like that's all we talk about every day on our show, and I know you probably do as well. But there are positives to NIL, and now – when these kids look at pro options, especially in basketball, and being very, very few, you know, options as far as rounds to be drafted, you know, the money drops pretty quickly. And if you're very, I mean, if you're a big piece of the pie for the college that you're playing for, your NIL deal could possibly be as good, if not better, for you to stay. And we're starting to see some of these kids make that decision where we thought, man, they're definitely a shoe-in to leave. They maybe aren't anymore. And so you look at the production that Janai Broome comes back with, what he was able to do the last couple of years. I mean, I think he'll probably be the preseason favorite for SEC Player of the Year. I think he'll be in the talk as preseason National Player of the Year. He brings that much back with him. He's the key component of this Auburn team. You know, Bruce Pearl is doing a really good job of getting this roster locked down pretty quick. You know, there's a lot of teams hemorrhaging players right now. And, you know, they got a lot of work to do to gain some people back. Auburn's lost three. You know, they've lost KD Johnson and Aiden Holloway and Trey Donald. And look, you're going to have attrition. But for the most part, the Denver Jones, the Chaney Johnson, the Janai Broome now, Dylan Cardwell, Chad Baker-Mazar, Simo coming back, Chris Morris. All of those guys are back. And then you had Todd Pettiford and you had Ja'Kai Howard into the mix coming in, the new guys. Auburn really only has a couple spots left on the roster to fill. So the nucleus of this team is built already. And, you know, the faster you can do that, obviously the better it is, because there's not as much of a learning curve for everybody and you can get to work pretty quick. So huge piece for him to go ahead and sit here in April, make a decision that he's coming back to Auburn, going to be part of this team, and, you know, now you can start building things up.
Yeah, I agree with you. On paper, Auburn has, I would say right now, probably the most impressive roster in the SEC coming back for next season. As you said, nobody's going to keep their roster completely intact, and Auburn's losing a lot from its backcourt. Of course, we'll talk more about the young man that's coming in a moment. But I want to ask you about Aiden Holloway, because obviously there's a lot of interest right now in his potential and future with Alabama being involved, and I wouldn't be shocked at all if he winds up committing to Alabama. This was a guy, I remember when Auburn signed him, you just thought, wow, superstar. I mean, scoring point guard, you know, charismatic, and again, as I was talking about earlier in the show, it's not like he had a terrible year at Auburn, but it just didn't. What went wrong? I mean, why didn't it go the way that it looked like it would go? I don't know how high Bruce Pearl was on him. What went wrong with Aiden Holloway?
You know, I don't really know. You know, and I think a lot of people look at player by player basis, and you know, sometimes there's not an answer. It wasn't because he wasn't getting playing time. It wasn't because Bruce Pearl wasn't putting him out there and trying to make this thing work for him. You know, I can see where some players maybe get disgruntled where they lose minutes, or you know, they're on the bench, or they're, you know, the coach just doesn't feel like it's their time, and maybe they do, and you know, they're like, I got to get out of here. I got to go find another place. That's not the case with Aiden Holloway. His shot just didn't fall for about 75% of the year. You know, I think starting off, we saw glimpses of how very talented he is. I mean, he was a five-star McDonald's All-American, highly, highly recruited by a lot of teams. And, you know, the two things that I saw for him, and it became a mental deal. And, Gary, I think so sports, for a lot of players, if you're playing golf and you shank a couple of shots, man, then it's mental. You're a field goal kicker. Mm-hmm. You miss two. Now you start trying to overcompensate and try to change your motion. I watched Aiden Holloway's jump shot, and it looked like he changed some things because the shots weren't falling. And he was getting, you could see him visibly frustrated on the court. It's not that he was, you know, forcing up dumb shots. He was missing some really open shots that you felt like he had a good, and they would rim out. You know, we talked about this numerous times. I mean, it was just right there. I mean, these balls were going down and then popping out, and it just felt like, man, you know, he's right on the cusp of getting this thing turned around. And I just think the frustration built. But you look down and Bruce was giving him 16, 18 yeah. minutes a game, but his stat line was 2 points, 4 points, one assist. And, you know, the other thing that he struggled with, in my opinion, was being able to get off of a defender. You know, he just could not turn the corner like a Mark Sears or some of these other guards that you see. And again, he's a freshman. He's trying to learn. So I don't think it was anything other than, you know, frustration from he was in a slump. And then we saw spurts, the Georgia game where he scored 20 points, and you said, man, you know, where's that Aiden Holloway been? Mm-hmm. And then it was right back to the old Aiden. So, you know, sometimes you need to change the venue. Sometimes maybe, and we don't know all that goes on, Gary, inside. And so and I don't think there's any disgruntledness there. I really don't. I just think that possibly he wants to make a change, and maybe it's best for him to make a change at this point. But he is very talented, and there's no doubt in my mind I think it'll click eventually. I mean, you don't go from being the kind of player he was to just not knowing how to play basketball anymore. So I think it's something he's got to battle through, and I think he will. But, yeah, I mean, I hate to lose the kid. I mean, I definitely do here as an Auburn person. But, you know, again, that's the world we live in now. And, you know, Auburn's got a really good guard coming in this freshman class to go along with the transfer Auburn just picked up. So I think Auburn's going to be in pretty good shape.
Yeah, if you need a change of venue, this is the right era to be playing in, because Lord knows you can leave anytime you want. And as you mentioned, Auburn is losing to Holloway, Donaldson, and Johnson. But you mentioned the freshman, right. and then J.P. Pegues coming in. I guess that's the guy that I wanted to focus on from the portal, because we're seeing this all around the country now. High Power 5 teams going and finding these mid-major players that are accomplished and have put up big numbers, and they come right in, they're ready to go. This is a guy coming in from Furman, 18.4 points per game on 36.2% shooting from behind the three-point line and 4.8 assists. So it feels like that J.P. Pegues is going to come in and be plugged in as a starter right away to me. What about, you know, how do you see it from the Auburn perspective?
There's no question. I think he's your starting point guard. I think Denver Jones and Tahai Pettiford to split time. There at the two as starters. I mean, again, Bruce Pearl likes to build depth. If you look at the minutes, even Janai Broome, 22, 23 minutes tops a lot of times. There's a lot of substitution going on to try to keep players fresh. And, you know, you want to build that quality depth. So I think Auburn may even try to go get one more guard to go with this bunch. But you've got, like I said, a veteran coming in Pegues, who – I think he's ready to go. When you have a transfer come in, especially in basketball, there is no sitting around waiting. You're expecting that player to come in and contribute right away. So I think he really fills a big void there at the point guard position and really frees Denver Jones up to be that shooter. Tahai Pettiford comes in as the number one combo guard in the country. He's a great point guard, and Bruce talked about that, but he really wants him to be a scorer. So he's looking at him more at that two position. So really feel good about it. You know, that's the whole deal in basketball about going out and getting one or two key guys out of the portal can really just change the face of your team. I mean, Jani Broome did that coming from Morehead State. I mean, you saw Grant Nelson this year for Alabama, how big of an addition that was for him, for Alabama. So big, big need position was that point guard position. And I'll be honest with you, since Jared Harper, Auburn has been able to mix and mingle some guys at point guard, and obviously they thought Aiden Holloway was going to be able to take over that role, and it didn't work out. Auburn really hasn't had a point guard to really take over games or be confident enough that they can score but get the ball to other players the way they need to do it from that position. So I think there's a lot of expectations with JP Pegues.
Let's switch to football, because I know last week we didn't really give it. Auburn's been active. You know, one thing that obviously that Hugh Freeze made a priority was getting Auburn back on track recruiting. He's done that. You've been busy. And also, I know Auburn's going to be looking at the portal. So what's going on there as far as new additions for Auburn football?
You know, we went through this this week, kind of by position by position. And, you know, believe it or not, quarterback, I think, unless something just pops up that Hugh Freeze feels like he's got to have, I don't think there's going to be a lot of heavy pursuit there from the quarterback. But definitely wide receiver still, even with a talented wide receiver core that Auburn has. They're young. A couple of guys really not even on campus yet, Perry Thompson and Malcolm Simmons. Bryce Kane, Cam Coleman were able to go through, but Robert Lewis on campus. You see still some area for some veteran guys. So Auburn's really looking at Keandre Lambert-Smith from Penn State, who got in the portal. He's four-year player for Penn State, but, you know, a lot of teams after his services, and he had a really good year this past year, probably his best year at Penn State. So I think he's rated like the number 13 wide receiver in the portal coming out. So definitely there. I think Auburn needs some help at the edge position as well from depth perception. And a kid to look there as a kid from Arkansas State, Karrion Crawford, excuse me. That's a guy that I think Auburn's really pursuing heavily, along with a kid from Miami. And Najalik Kelly, he's also a top 15 guy at his position in the portal. So really not as many needs as you would think, Gary, in this portal. I mean, normally we're talking about going out and getting offensive linemen, but Auburn was able to do that in the first portal window and get a big tackle from Mississippi State in the Lewis kid that's come in and already been contributing. So really just a few areas. I think the edge rusher position, like I said, and still maybe trying to go out and get a couple more wide receivers. But the running backs, pretty solid. You got four guys back there. And then the secondary, even though we lost some key guys, you know, you were able to get Thompson to come in from Texas. You got Keontae Scott back. So that's not as barren as it once looked. So I think maybe it has to be the right situation and right player. But those are kind of the key areas Auburn's looking at right now.
Baseball-wise, it just doesn't seem like it's going to get any better. You had Kentucky at home last week. You lost one of those one-run games that Auburn's lost so many of. And then, on Thursday. And then on Friday, you get handled. Then on Saturday, you got a 7-0 lead over Kentucky and wind up losing that game 13-8. And I did come back and win the midweek game going to Mississippi State this weekend. Is baseball just too far gone, or are Auburn people holding out hope that they can somehow turn this thing around?
You know, I think every week we've said Auburn needs to win a series. Auburn needs to win a series, and they just haven't been able to do it. And, you know, you've got to look at where Auburn sits right now with only two wins in conference, but I broke this down on the show yesterday. Every team left on Auburn's schedule has a losing record. And, I mean, we knew this thing was top heavy. Who thought Kentucky would be 14-1 at this point? Nobody would have said that. We expected A&M to be good. We knew Arkansas would be good. Knew Tennessee would be good. But, you know, those are all who Auburn's played to this point. Now they've got Mississippi State, LSU, Ole Miss, Missouri, and Alabama. And, yeah, all those names are top names, but LSU's won three games. Ole Miss is under 500. I think Mississippi State, this is a big series for them.
Yeah.
They're only, I think they're 7-8.
And
if they were to get a big series win here at home with a banged up, beat up Auburn team that just can't catch a break, they look at this as a must win. I think they're looking for a sweep even. But Auburn can turn the thing around as best as they can, but it's got to start against this Mississippi State. And they've got a run of five series here. And if they win all of those series, Gary, now that's a long stretch, but they've been in a lot of games that they lost. Those one-run games went their way last year. This year they haven't so much. So can they turn it around? It starts tonight in Starkville. And, you know, you come out of this one getting swept or only winning one game, I think it's pretty much over at that point.
Yeah, I'm with you though. I'm going to Starkville. It's not nearly as daunting as it's been in some years.
Oh, no.
So
definitely not.
Yeah, softball showing some life last weekend and encouraging what they were able to do.
Absolutely. I mean, again, I think this softball team. We've talked about it ad nauseum, Gary. The pitching has been there. The thing that's hampered Mickey Dean over his entire career at Auburn has been the offense. Again, big win on the road against LSU, 2 out of 3 there. You come back home this weekend to a good Kentucky team, but a beatable Kentucky team. And then you finish up with Ole Miss and Alabama. I mean, all of those are winnable series. Auburn's sitting there at 5-10. If they can win that series this weekend, you know, now all of a sudden you're 7-11, and then with 2 more series left, I mean, you can get this thing close to 500 in SEC play. I mean, they're 23-13-1 right now. We saw this team really kind of catch fire at the end last year. So big time positive to go on the road at LSU. You've got a great program and get 2 out of 3 there. And now you come home. And you have a top 25, I think they're 24 in the country, top 25 Kentucky team at your place. You got to take advantage of it. Mm-hmm. You got to win the series if you want to get back in it.
All right, my friend. Great synopsis as always. And I know that for people that want to follow Auburn all the time, every day, you guys provide that opportunity with the Auburn Blitz.
Yeah, we do. A lot to talk about again today. Our good friend, as always, Jason Caldwell from Auburn Undercover will be on the show today to discuss football recruiting, to talk about this basketball roster, and then, of course, what you and I just talked about with baseball and softball. So, looking forward to it.
And I saw on a non-related note to Auburn, I love those pictures from the smallmouth trip you took up to Pickwick. Man, those are the prettiest fish. And let me ask you this, because you're such an avid fisherman, before we go, because I know we think of smallmouth fishing mainly in the Midwest and in the northern part of the country. Is there a better smallmouth fishery in the country than Pickwick?
No, there's not. I mean, smallmouth fishing is king in Minnesota and Michigan, and it's hard to beat up in New York. I mean, just great smallmouth fisheries, huge trophy smallmouth. But anywhere below the Mason-Dixon line, you will not find a lake better than Pickwick in North Alabama. The Tennessee River as a whole, I mean, every lake, Wilson, Wheeler, Pickwick, Gunnersville, the Tennessee River is a awesome fishery. And you know, it just continues to produce great fishing. And, you know, it's got a lot more pressure than it did before,
mm-hmm.
With more people getting into fishing and in those lakes getting popular with, you know, magazine articles and online articles. And it draws people in from all over the country. But I definitely encourage you, if you want to go catch a quality smallmouth, go find your way to Lake Pickwick or Wilson. And they're there, man. It's a lot of fun. It's a fun time.
It looks like y'all cleaned up again, man. I'm telling you. And those are just such pretty fish. Nothing against largemouth fishing, because that's king here. But man, those are, they're not,
right.
A largemouth's just not as pretty as a smallmouth. They're just not.
Well, they are. They're unique, and they fight really hard. They're one of the top freshwater sport fish out there. Like you said, I like to catch both of them, but my son regularly whips my tail now, so he and his buddy in their boat, and me and my friend in my boat, they whipped us both days, so I may not let them go back next year.
All right, Brett, have a good weekend, man.
Yeah, appreciate it.
All right, 10:52. We'll take a timeout, and we'll come back and wrap it up for another week here on the Gary Harris Show right after this. Los Tarascos has been serving Mexican favorites like burritos, fajitas, and quesadillas since 1999. Their new location is at 4100 Owen Parkway in Northport. And, of course, you can find Los Tarascos in Tuscaloosa at 110 Skyland Boulevard. The bar areas feature big-screen television so you can enjoy your favorite sporting events. Los Tarascos features daily.
We'll plan by April 20th. Get one application free. Visit TrueGreen.com for the best lawn at the best price guaranteed. Restrictions apply.
Tide 100.9, Tuscaloosa weather.
The weather stays warm today, mostly cloudy through tonight. A few scattered showers or thunderstorms possible. A high today, 84. Tonight's low, 60. Tomorrow, mostly cloudy. A few passing showers are likely during the day. The high, 74. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 73 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
You're listening to the home of Alabama Crimson Tide sports. 100.9.
All right, 10:54. We're winding it down, and we're winding it down even quicker than usual because we got to hit baseball here in just about a minute. So I'm going to go ahead and get out real quickly. Somebody shot me a social media message and said I talked about the two incoming players from the portal, but didn't name them, and they're right. Houston Millett, shooting guard from Pepperdine, and Chris Youngblood, shooting guard from South Florida. Those are the two additions from the portal so far for Alabama basketball. But like I said, don't be shocked if there's another one sometime today or by this evening. So we'll keep an eye out for that. All right, we're going to get on out of here so we can make way for Alabama baseball taking on Texas A&M. This hour of the Gary Harris Show has been brought to you by Patterson Comer Attorneys at Law. For Justin Jones, I'm Gary Harris. Thanks for listening and have a great weekend. And we'll be back Monday morning to recap what will be a busy weekend in sports, including, of course, the Geico 500 if they get to run that on Sunday at Talladega.